Welcome to the second half of the Selma Mayoral Forum. If folks are just joining us on the radio at 96.3 WJAM, that is what you are listening to. The local leaders here in town who will be the next main city leader here in the city of Selma. They are Mayor George Evans, Representative Dario Milton, Councilman Greg Milton, Reverend James Perkins, and Minister Julia Martin. And to start off for our second half of this debate, so we're going to focus on infrastructure. We're going to go in this order: Martin, Evans, Milton, Belkin, Perkins, and you will each have 1 minute to answer the questions in this category. So question number one: considering our current economic condition, what is your plan to address the need for road resurfacing, excessive potholes, and shortage of stoplights at many intersections? Ms. Martin.
So what we have to understand is that there are several ways to go for funding for infrastructure. We have to also remember that there are not only public funds available, but also private. So Selma can also be applying for those private funds as well as public, and those public funds being state and federal grants that provide funding for our infrastructure. And so right now it seems as if we've been taking out loans to do this when there's actually free money. And I myself, as a seasoned grant writer, sat down at the computer and within just 10 minutes, I was able to pinpoint over 20 different grants that could bring over $20 million to our city. So I'm saying that there's work to be done in infrastructure. I have the skill set and the zeal to do it. So let's get to work.
Mr. Evans?
Yes, infrastructure is certainly one of the primary things we must work on. Our city is an old city. Our city was actually incorporated in 1820. And there is a lot of work to go on infrastructure. The pothole situation is that we have now purchased a pothole truck and we're working on potholes. And potholes will be aware of the past in no time because that's in operation right now. Researching the streets, I would say this, that through the ATRA program, we got $9 million in certain thoroughfares in our city. That came from our government. We worked on that. The other point I would say that in talking to our public works department people and asking them how much would it take for us to find funding to do just a block in our city for researching, $100,000, at least $100,000 cost just to research the street for one block. So at the end of the day, grants and all like that are important, and we're right now doing a study for our city for the sole purpose of identifying the strengths and weaknesses of our city so that within a year, we all have an identified problem in terms of strength, weakness, and the location is one toward eight.
Mr. Miller.
When we talk about infrastructure, we have to really think about what we're talking about. We're talking about more than just roads and bridges, but we're talking about lighting, we're talking about water and sewer, we're talking about our parks. So in the Milton administration, what we would love to do with regards to our infrastructure is to go into the mayor's office and work with the council and see what areas on each council board that is prime priority. Now, how will we pay for that? There's three ways we can pay for it. The bond market, which I totally discourage at this moment. Second, we can restructure some spending that we have going on now in City Hall. Because right now we may be spending money in other areas where we may need to take it to infrastructure because infrastructure is important. And thirdly, we will look at public-private partnerships that the city can partner with private businesses to provide the resources that we need to have a strong infrastructure. So in the Milton administration, we'll find out what the problems are, we'll put a tag on it, and we'll figure out how to get it paid.
Mr. Dolan.
Thank you very much. I wanted to say I wanted to start a dedicated street crew, and a dedicated sidewalk crew. This crew will do nothing but stay on top of our street repairs, our potholes, and the trees along our street, among other things. I see so many problems that can be fixed before they get to be big problems and expensive problems. They can be taken care of early on before they get to be big problems. Our citizens will begin to see that there's work being done and know that if this little problem is not going to get to be a big, this little hole is not going to get to be a big hole. So I think to tackle it head on first before they get to be big, yes, there is funding available in various ways, but that's always been my dream, to have dedicated crews that just target and concentrate on these problems and before they get to be big ones. Thank you.
Mr. Clerk. I would purchase the equipment necessary to form our curb gutter and sidewalk. City of Selma cannot afford to contract that worked out, but we could afford the raw material. We can afford to train our existing labor force how to use that equipment so that we can have curb gutter and sidewalk in every neighborhood. Also, I wouldn't shut the door on bond money at this point. Why? Because if you can find a bond that can be floated with a lower interest rate than the current debt, then you can actually reduce your out-of-pocket expenses monthly on the cost of that bond debt. And finally, I would clean the gutters. If you clean the gutters and you clean the ditches, the water will flow, our streets won't flood as frequent and as often as they do. And so those are some key things. Finally, there's a $2 million worth of grant money that we should be getting every 8 years. During the Smitherman administration, he got $2 million in the last 8 years of administration. I got $2 million during my administration over the 8 year period. Grant money didn't have to be repaid.
Next question. What is your plan for the historic district? How will you address the abandoned buildings downtown and dilapidated housing in the city? Ms. Martin.
First, it starts with one word or two words, code enforcement. This is something that our administration will take seriously. We are going to enforce the codes that are already on the book, but we're also going to be an administration that tells you about the opportunities that are available. Did you know that there is currently a 20% historic tax credit that business owners can be applying for here in Selma, or just local residents who would like to fix up a building downtown for profit? So there's so many opportunities that are available for our historic district. So my job as mayor is going to be to highlight what can be done while also enforcing those codes that are already on the books so that we can be the beautiful Selma that God made us to be.
Mr. Evans?
Yes, I would totally agree that there is truly room for code enforcement improvements, no doubt about that. Certainly, as a result of that, we are working on trying to improve the process by which we identify homes that need to be demolished, and we've been able to demolish over 200 homes since I've been mayor during this time. However, we work with HUD in order to bring about funding and grants for the sole purpose of choice neighborhoods as we're trying to work with to retain our historic district, because it's going under at this point based on the owners of these properties who are not doing anything with them. So the city council is putting this work together in terms of creating ordinances which definitely identify what you must do in order to keep abandoned homes up to par. And when that has more teeth in it, we're gonna be able to do a better job of making sure that those ordinances are followed and code enforcement people as well as police are making sure that they are.
Mr. Miller.
When tourists drive into our city, the first neighborhoods they witness is Ward 3 and Ward 8. And they judge us based off of those wards. And so in the Melton administration, we're going to make sure we enforce the codes. That those who stay in those wards, we're going to make sure that their homes throughout the whole city, but particularly in those wards, they're up to par, that their yards are cut, that the grass is cut, that the lots are clean. So what would it look like? The historic tax credit, which was mentioned, guess who helped champion that legislation over Montgomery? Your state legislator. And when it passed, I called City Hall, we got nothing from it. See, that's why I'm running for mayor, because I know the things that are available for us on the city level, state level, and the federal level. I want to be able to pull those resources down to make sure we can rehab and revitalize downtown Selma, to make sure we can rehab and revitalize our historic district. As mayor of Selma, our future looks very bright.
Yes, I want to thank you. Ward 3 contains three historic districts, Riverview, Ice House, and Old Town. And I saw them very well familiar with all that there. But this has always been a point of irritation with me. Hold property owners responsible. It is not the city's job. I don't care where you live. I don't care if you moved out of the state. You still have responsibility to your property. And as everyone said here, yeah, let's enforce these codes. Let's get these dang cars out of the yard. Yes, there are historic tax credits. I just came from Mobile this weekend, Historic Alliance. We learned a lot about that. It's always a big thing. Yes, tourism. Tourists drive into this town. They want to see our historic district. They want to see our beauty and our history. They don't want to be upset. They want to see what we have to show off, and it needs to be always looking dropping on us. And I want to say this, under the code enforcement, the weed abatement process, the process for dilapidated houses, is way too long. It needs to be cut in half. They get one letter, 10 days later, we're there.
I have been proactive with this issue since I started campaigning for office. I have met with contractors and developers who have expressed an interest in investing in our community to help us rebuild our neighborhoods. They simply want someone in the office of mayor who is business friendly, understand the transactions that they have a desire to do, and that will be willing to move our municipal government swiftly so that their money does not sit too long on the streets. In addition, we tore down 450 houses while I was in office. I don't think we need to continue with the demolition process. I think we need to look at rehabilitation, and we need to look at issues like lead abatement and those kinds of issues to identify monies and resources that will be available for that. Finally, I have pulled down state and federal money to do this before, and I can do it again.
We're going to move on to city services now. We're going to go in this order: Evans, Melton, Belkey, Perkins, Martin, and you will each have 1 minute to answer these questions. Number one, do you support an increase in the salaries of the low-paid city employees, not high-paid department heads, to a wage that is comparable with similar-sized cities? Will you support developing an employee pay scale and offer pay raises based on performance evaluations? Mr. Evans.
Yes, everything you said, I totally agree with from the standpoint of raising those who are down at the bottom and not necessarily those who are the higher echelon. I think that there should be a margin whereby there is a phase in of those persons who are down there making the minimum wage, whereby their salaries can be substantially higher or greater than those who are the department heads, but I think that they have been under the gun for a long time. So yes, the pay plan program that we're trying to place now is working toward trying to make sure that every employee through job description, based on years of service, based on education, based on that, will be paid according to their work ethics from the standpoint of even incentive package and things like that. So yes, I support our employees getting a pay raise, employee based on years of service, based on their ability to do the job, as well as the fact that they need more money because the quality of life needs to change.
Mr. Milton.
On this campaign trail, I've been fortunate enough to talk with many people. And the other day, I had the opportunity, I won't call his name, but talked to a city employee who works with the Public Works Department, who's been there for over 20 years and still making the bare minimum. That's totally unacceptable in the Duncan administration. As I said about law enforcement, if we take care of our city employees, I believe they'll take care of us. And so, yes to that question.
Mr. Bilton.
Yes, certainly the answer is yes to that question, and there is a pay plan that is in progress that the council has voted on. But yes, increasing salaries for the folks that are doing all the hard work. I constantly get a warm feeling when I see the crews that are out and they're dedicated with our public works crew and our street crews. Their dedication to Selma is wonderful. It's good to see them out there. But yes, by all means, I'm all for finding a pay increase for them. But their dedication right now is to be applauded. I'm thankful for them. Thank you.
Mr. Perkins.
I've set a goal to increase the minimum pay for city employees by 31% within the next 2 years. That means that the pay would go from $7.25 an hour to $9.50 per hour. And I can say without hesitation that that can be done. When I went into office, the minimum pay for city employees was $5.35 an hour. When I left office, it was $7.25 an hour, and that was before the federal government raised the minimum wage to $7.25. I did it before, I can do it again. And that was another part of the question, performance evaluations. Yes, I would match job descriptions to job performance, and there will be systematic job evaluations, performance evaluations done under my administration. That's the way it was done before, I will do it again.
Ms. Martin.
I plan offer competitive salaries for all positions in City Hall. And I want to send out the message that we are all in the same boat. So to send that message out, the first cut that is going to come when we sit down to do our prioritized budget is going to be from the mayoral salary. I'm going to tell them that I seek to serve, not to profit. We have to have a mayor with a servant's heart that is here for the people, to be the voice of the people, and to let our workers, to let our people know that we are all in the same boat. So there is no way that I, as your mayor, can sit in City Hall knowing that someone is making the bare minimum, and I'm making close to $100,000 a year. Will come from the mayor's office.
Next question. How will you improve the overall delivery and quality of city services, i.e. water, sanitation, trash, etc.? Mr. Evans.
Well, that's an area that certainly, as we have already begun evaluating all of our departments and so purpose of trying to find ways to improve services. That is so critical. So I'd like to say sometimes you pay for what you get. So as a result of that, that's something that's ongoing through things that we're doing, and I believe with all my heart that once we are able to get the salary package where it needs to be and put the city programs in, and they're already being evaluated annually from the standpoint of supervisors, there is a lot of work to be done, and I can't sit here and tell you everything's in place until perfect, because there's a lot of work to be done. And no matter who's mayor, there's things that need to be done, and I'm not going to stand here and make promises that I won't be able to carry out. I'm going to stand here and tell you what I can do, and I'm going to do exactly what I said.
Mr. Miller?
When I was a young boy, I remember trash was picked up twice a week. Twice a week. But since Miller left office, it was cut in half, prices have gone up, and you're getting worse services. It's totally unacceptable for those who we partner with to pick up our trash, that they leave our streets dirty when they're picking up the trash. So in the Melton administration, if we could get back to in-housing those services, we would do that. But in the meanwhile, we want to make sure we put pressure on those who we are in partnership right now to make sure that they don't leave our city dirty. That's what we're doing in the Melton administration.
Mr. Pelkin.
One of the things that I've always dreamed of having too, and that I propose as mayor, is I feel like our public works crew are spread way too thin. I would like to have a public works crew for each ward, maybe comprising of 4 to 5 people. This crew would monitor just the activities that needs to be done in that ward. They would, in that way, they would know the citizens' ward. They would know what needs to be done before the work request goes in. They would cruise their ward daily and every day. They would know what needs to be done. Secondly, I think Parks and Recreation needs to take care of Parks and Recreation. Right now, our recreation crew takes care of recreation, but I think all our parks need to be managed here. But that's one of the things I think that I would love to see put in place is each ward had its own public works crew, and that would need the equipment. They would take care of that ward as if it were their own yard. And they would know the residents. They would know who's doing right and who's doing wrong. So that would be one of the main things that I wanted to do. Thank you.
Mr. Perkins.
Well, talking to citizens on the street, I have determined that there is a difference, a disparity, if you will, in the strategies and the collection of trash between neighborhoods. That will not exist under my administration. Everybody will be treated the same. Yes, we went to a single day collection because it was more efficient with the roll-out cans. The cans were large enough. I do not agree, never have agreed, with outsourcing the garbage service. We knew from a comprehensive study that was done that what we are seeing now would happen if we outsourced garbage. I would reevaluate this whole process. Can't tell you exactly how it would be done or what would be done because I have not had an opportunity to see the entire contract, but it will be revisited. The litter vacs will be brought back in full, and I think Councilwoman Keith has a good idea with recycling.
Ms. Martin.
What I can promise you that I will do as your next mayor is bring city services back to the city. Give it back to the people. people. I will have every departmental head meeting with our community members on a monthly basis so that you can tell them exactly how you feel. You can tell them what challenges you are facing in your community and pertaining to trash or water or any public service that we offer. I promise you that you will not have to wait another 4 years to voice your concern. You can do it every day at City Hall, and you will be able to do it on a monthly basis when we have our city service heads of departments available to you. Thank you.
Final question in this category. There is a considerable amount of trash found on the streets of our cities. If you're elected mayor, what do you plan to do with the cleanliness of the environment for our city? Mr. Evans.
Yes, there is a lot of trash that's been deposited on our city. And we're working on trying we have carts there that they're supposed to put this trash in. We have citizens sometime now who will ride around and just throw trash out and make it take our city bad. And so we have public enforcement people, we have two police officers who are working to try to catch these individuals who are dumping trash in our city. However, there are some citizens of Selma who will run to a traffic light and stop there and just take trash out and put it right at the traffic light and pull off. So we have a lot of work to do. We have a lot of work to do in terms of in-house as well as what's going on from the out of the house. But at the end of the day, I'm working hard, but right now through the process of code enforcement, through cameras that we're trying to place in different locations, in order to identify these people who trash our city. That is a tremendous problem, and we're never going to stop doing it until we can get everybody on board.
Mr. Milton.
I think it's a simple thing. When I was growing up, my mom always told me to clean up behind myself. So we're going to clean up behind ourselves, clean the city. Simple. Don't have a whole plan in place for that. Just pick up the trash. That's what we're doing tonight.
This is an area that's been.
One second, Mr. Belkey, if we could just.
There we are.
Mr. Belkey.
This is an area that's very dear to me, that's keeping things important. I propose absolutely nothing on the streets but yard debris. Everything else, boxes, mattresses, toilets, I'm sick of seeing it. Building supplies would have to go to a transfer station or a recycling center. Maybe there'd be two in our city. I am convinced that people come from out of our city limits. They are bringing it into the city because the city picked it up free. I have witnessed it firsthand. I've seen stacks of tires as tall as my head dumped in alleys. I'm tired of nothing on the streets but yard debris. And I don't care if leaves are bagged. I don't care. But I don't want to see anything on the streets. Anything else, if you haul that out to the street, then you can haul it to a transfer station. I don't want to see it.
Mr. Perkins.
Everything that we've talked about today is tied directly into my smart city strategy. But I want you to understand that it really is the job of the mayor to make sure that we have a garbage and trash collection plan. In fact, it is a mandatory requirement by the Alabama Department of Environmental Management that we do this plan every 10 years. And so we need to reevaluate that plan. What I am doing is I am sharing as many facts and managerial requirements of the office of mayor as I can within a 1 minute period. Every time I see that 30 second sign flash over there, I begin to rush. The other thing is outsourcing simply is not going to work as long as the contractors are picking up the cans if they're not being paid. We have to change that provision in the contract. If it's there, it needs to be removed. If it's not there, then we need to look, reevaluate how we actually make certain that citizens actually pay their fees on time.
Ms. Martin.
Let me begin by saying, guys, we have to take this seriously. While it may seem that it's insignificant, we have to understand that throwing trash and littering is only a symptom of the larger problem at hand, which is hopelessness and low morale in our communities. We have to work to energize our communities. I'm a part of a program called Keep It Clean Selma, where every third Saturday we're out in our communities picking up trash. This is the type of things I will bring into City Hall programming, where we're coming together, where you will see your mayor in her jogging suit and tennis shoes out picking up trash, letting you know that we are one Selma and that together we can make a difference. We have to give hope where hope has been lost. We have to boost that morale. If you think that trash is just a trivial problem, guys, we have to come together to realize the bigger problem that our city is facing.
We're going to move on now to communities and neighborhoods. You each will have 1 minute to answer the questions in this category. We're going to go in this order: Melton, Belton, Perkins, Martin, Evans. Question number one: if you are elected mayor, what are your plans to address racial divisions in Selma and unify our city? Mr. Melton.
I think it's very important that we acknowledge, yes, there is some tension in our city. But Selma is no different than any other city. There's tension in all cities. When we start talking about race relations. But I tell you this, it's only 10% of people in our city that causes the problems. The 99% of us want to work together. And so what I would do is focus on the 90 and let the 10 stay with themselves.
And do get along. It's a small group of folks that like to stir up trouble, and so everybody thinks, oh, there's racial division. Yes. Okay. Church services would be a big start. I don't think we have a billion churches necessary, but the churches are a very special place in people's lives. We want to get the race together. It could be just a small group of 10 people that would go to each church on a Sunday. Let's start small. I'm also a member of the Tuesday Night Men's Club. As Mayor Evans, we meet once a month at each other's homes. There's 16 black, there's 16 white. We keep it evenly just like that. Eating together is a very special, special time together. Very special. So my idea is start small. It could be the church, it could be in our homes, but that's how it gets going. But do remember, 90% of this town, the people do like each other and really are trying to get along.
Mr. Perkins?
I've often said that race is not an issue in and of itself, but it is a component of everything we deal with. We find it when we're dealing with economic development, we find it when we're trying to address issues of education, we find it in every aspect of our lives. And so my strategy is to not focus on race itself, but let's solve the jobs problem in our community, and let's deal with race as a component of that issue. Let's deal with the education issue, and let's deal with the racial component of that issue. Let's deal with our neighborhoods and our faith-based community, and let's allow race to be a component of those issues. By doing so, we can solve many of the problems that we have, and race will be resolved as a matter of dealing with the real issues that we face in our community.
Ms. Martin?
We have to understand that Selma is blessed with so many great churches and so many great organizations that are already working in our community towards race and religion relations. So what I want to be is that mayor that comes in to help us consolidate our efforts so that we can get more accomplished. You see, we don't have to reinvent the wheel. We just have to support and unite the wheels that are already turning. And I promise you, when we unite those wheels, when we come together truly as one Selma, that other 10% is going to have to join us or either leave our city.
I would say to you that certainly the racial tones in our city does exist. And I'll say this from the standpoint that percentage that said earlier, we have a lot of people, all 9% or even greater, who really want to see our city move forward. But there are a group out there who want to see our city fail. And as a result of that, they work against it. And they're making a lot of noise. But we have racial problems, not only within races, we have black on black problems. We have the dignity among ourselves. It's just not right, but we are our worst enemy. Because we are not doing the job we need to do. We work together to uplift each other.
What will you do to stop the random gunfire that happens in the middle of the night? Random shooting and stray bullets entering windows of homes terrify the community, especially near Selma High, Concordia College area. Mr. Miller.
As stated earlier, we have to have presence in our communities. With a Honda staff police department, we cannot ask our men and women on the 3 or 4 at nighttime on duty. That's totally unacceptable. So in the Meltem administration, I'm gonna work with Chief Brock to make sure we can expand and get to the number of officers we need. So 24/7, we will have officers in those communities. Now what else will we do? There's technology available in the 21st century that will allow officers to respond quickly in regards to gunfire going off. And so if the criminals know that we have quick response time, I think and I know that will discourage gun violence in our community. But there's also the issue when we start talking about homes. The mayor's office is not to be the one dad up home. We got to make sure that parents are being parents. And we got to make sure that granddaddies are being granddaddies. And grandmamas are being grandmamas. That's the way we get the balance in our community.
Mr. Bilton.
Thank you, legislator. Get back to closely monitoring the traffic in and out in our neighborhoods and throughout our town. I hate to use the word, but it has to be traffic stops, random traffic stops. I say do it. If you're not doing anything wrong, don't have anything to worry about. But also I want to say that but that's one way of doing it, and I just had a thought that's left me, Mr. Wood, I'm sorry. But let's, I'm blank. But that's one of the main things, is just closely monitoring and seeing it, and I'll think of it later. Sorry. Thank you.
Mr. Perkins.
There is gunfire locator technology that exists that many cities are using. That is a part of the Smart Cities plan that I am advocating and proposing. I'm also advocating for a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week monitoring center where we have cameras deployed in hotspots in our community and in our public spaces so that we can actually identify situations that can help police officers solve many of these crimes. But I am convinced that smart cities technology, connecting the people all across this community, in other words, putting mobile apps on our phones so that citizens can actually report issues that are happening in a timely way, it would make a tremendous difference. So I am advocating smart cities, that we deal with smart cities, and we do what is necessary technologically to aid the police officers that we have.
Ms. Martin.
Spending every Sunday the last 2 years in the Dallas County Jail listening to the voices of our felons and our pariahs of Selma society, I understand that yes, we do need an increased police presence, but we also need an increased peace presence. We also need an increased preacher presence. We have to go into these communities. We have to go into the jails to also bring hope where, again, hope has been lost. And when it comes to gang violence, I, as your mayor, will do what Compton's new mayor has done. I will go into these communities and I will meet with these gang members. I will be there to mitigate these problems. I will be there to negotiate peace. I am prepared to do this and probably one of the only ones on stage that is equipped with the knowledge and the skill set to do so.
Mr. Evans.
Let me say that we do have right now in our police department the information or improvement that identifies gunfire in our city. The question is, having that equipment, certainly, the gun is fired way over across town. By the time we get there, nobody was fired, but the individual gone. So we do have that equipment. However, keep this in mind also, I said something earlier that I got someone criticized for, and I want to clarify. I said to you guys something about in disguise. What I should have said was unidentified, okay? Now, the point I make is this. Here's the point I make. The fact that our police officers ride around in an unidentified car because that criminal element has a way of letting you know when we're around. So as a result, if they go out in police cars all the time that's identified, we won't solve a lot of our problems because they see us coming when we get there. So our police officers ride around in unidentified cars who are unmarked for the sole purpose of trying to catch up with that criminal element.
We're going to move on to the next generation of Selma. We'll go in this order. Belke, Perkins, Martin, Evans, Melton. And again, you'll each have 1 minute for each of these questions now. This is a long one, so get ready. Overall, young people of today are poorer than Generation X was 15 years ago, with fewer good job opportunities. The plight of the young people in Selma who graduated high school and college into one of the worst recessions America has ever seen is well documented. I believe that Selma can do a better job at fostering a creative energy that drives growth and helps young people launch careers. What will you do to appeal, attract, and retain millennials to Selma? Mr. Belke.
As I said earlier, we can spend millions of dollars on promoting our town. We can set up the biggest institution to educate everyone. But what good is it going to do to drag everybody in here if we haven't done our basic homework and cleaned ourselves up? They're going to turn around and they're going to go out and they're going to leave from here. We're not looking good to throw out the welcome mat. But I think our resources lie in our community, our colleges here, especially our community college that's training people to take school. And their IT department, that's very, very important. But we've got to lay the basic groundwork before we attract any of these young people in. And that's where the whole thing gets started. When we start cleaning up, they're going to come back. Thank you.
Mr. Perkins.
That really is a long question. Could you repeat that?
Overall, young people of today are poorer than Generation X was 15 years ago, with fewer good job opportunities. The plight of the young people in Selma who graduated high school and college into one of the worst recessions America has ever seen is well documented. I believe that Selma can do a better job at fostering a creative energy that drives growth and helps young people launch careers. What will you do to appeal, attract, and retain millennials to Selma?
Millennials are trained in areas of this new technology that exists, this cyber technology. We need to actually use the fiber to the home network that we have. We need to actually begin to support the entrepreneurs in our community by making certain that they have every opportunity using the fiber to home network to market their wares and their goods and services, not just in local community, but nationally and internationally. We need to use that network to identify that new industry that I spoke of, that industry that does not exist, that will provide the kinds of jobs and opportunities. That is a massive project. It is not something that can be done just locally. It's going to take everybody, a plan together, not just in Selma, but regionally. We're going to have to engage federal and state resources, but I am convinced that if we put our minds together, identified, it can be done.
Ms. Martin.
For me, I think that there is a lot that has already been set into place for us as millennials, which is one of the main reasons that I came back home to Selma after Princeton. But what I want to do is be an ambassador, be a spokesperson, that to let all of my peers know that they can come home and find good jobs. And if they can't find a good job, they can create one, as I did with the Circle of Hope Ministries. So out of my office, I'm going to be suggesting something that I call 20 Bucks Success, which I have done the research and found over 30 different professions that you can start with only 20 bucks. And so this is something that I would like to bring to the table, but to also just encourage our young people that we have to come and bless Selma together.
Mr. Evans?
You made a statement that our young people are poor. And I would agree that to a certain extent. I will say this too, that our young people have more advantages and opportunities than ever before now since I came up. They have more exposure and more technology abilities than ever before. I feel that our children are not taking advantage of the opportunities that's available to them. They don't do what they need to do in the ghetto. Now, point I would make also is that our HR programs, I said earlier, is trying to find ways, and they are getting into the school, the junior high level, high school, in the plans that are coming into the schools, work with our teachers and working with the counselors in order to make sure that our young people know what's available to them by staying at home. Sometimes going away from home to have a job is not bad, because sometimes you go and learn something and bring it back. Sometimes it's better to stay here at home also to improve the economy. So I think it has a working relationship from the standpoint of leave and come back here as well as stay at home and improve the quality of life.
Mr. Miller.
First, I would not criticize this generation about what they are not doing, but about what we are not doing. When I ran for office in 2010, they said I was too young to be at the table. Now that they said I should have ran for city council or ran for municipality, now that I'm running for mayor, they say I'm too young to be mayor. So we have to create an environment where we invite young people to the table. That's what we have to do first of all. Second of all, the infrastructure that we have in place, the fiber optic infrastructure that we have in place, we have to make sure that we use that infrastructure, because right now it's not being used, to create the jobs of the 21st century. 3D printing, cybersecurity, computer programming, production design. We can do that right here in Selma and have our kids work on Broad Street or Ward Avenue. You know, for too long we've been talking in Selma about being the magnet. Selmians, it's time for us to be that magnet.
So, Vince, we're going to take questions from the audience. Each candidate will be asked one question from the audience. Ministers from the audience will ask these questions. You will have 2 minutes to answer. And I will call the candidate's name, which will correspond to the minister that will come up to read that question. Evans.
So, moderator, thank you so much. And to our candidates, thank you for a great debate so far, and to our audience. My question is for the mayor, and in fact, this was in each box. Each one of the candidates was asked this question in their box, and we selected to ask it to Ed Evans. Unity among schools. The schools are currently segregated. How would you work to integrate them, or would you work to integrate them at all?
There's no doubt I think that needs to be begun. There needs to be a dialogue between schools, administrators, boards, and parents. That's what a student body is, to find a way, if it's possible, that we can integrate and get back together. Because in prior to 1990, we had an awesome school district. And some things happened in 1990, this burst out of cities, and we have not regained from here. Keeping in mind that I feel that is a dialogue that should take place, not to mean that it should be automatic, but it should be done. So I would work in everything that I do, because I do programs right now through scholarship programs that include all school children, private and public, for the benefit of getting a scholarship through a program that I started 5 years ago. I do the same thing with special needs children through a scholarship program through the Gotham Tournament. And so all of these funds go to children, and that makes up all of our children, public education, private education, and even county schools. So there is a need to have that dialogue, a need to talk about the fact of how can we come together and see what is best for our children, what is best for our community in terms of moving forward. That's a long process, and it can be taken out of context if it's perceived wrong. So I would look toward trying to find a way to find the right process by which we can sit at the table and talk about what's best for our city, for our county, and for the children who live here in Selma, Dallas County.
No.
How do we use the Alabama River as a resource for tourism and economic development?
That's a good question. How do they use our river? There's so much in our city that we are not using. For instance, the amphitheater that we have in place, we are not using it. Maybe it may be us finishing that amphitheater and bringing in groups and things to have some kind of life down there. But the river, what do we do with the river? I believe we have to open it up, and I think the group here locally did it last year in September, to have boating on the river, maybe to have canoeing on the river. Imagine we have that stuff tied in with our historical context. I'll tell you this, as mayor of this city, we won't die from going into that river. And the legislature, that is something in regards to the civil rights artifacts. We want people diving into that river, getting those artifacts out. Why? What it would look like if we create a Civil War museum here in Selma? That drives up money for our economy, drives up money for our city. And so those are some things that we'll look at when it comes to using that river, using it for diving, using it for entertainment purposes, and using it for sports purposes. That's what we'll do here in Selma.
Shelters in the city for homeless individuals and families.
Oh boy.
Yes, it is. In fact, those talks are going on right now but we have to, we're getting different organizations together that tell us what is needed, how many people are needing homeless facilities, what size of this need to be, are they male, are they female? Yes, the studies are going on now. I think the council has mentioned we've set in a couple of talks on this. It's a very important talk now, and Rock Street has a bad problem with that right now that we're trying to find. So yes, they are going on, but they're getting the data now. Let's just determine what are the needs that have to be done. And this has nothing to do with that, but I would like to make a proposal here to announce it. Those artifacts in the river are protected by the Alabama Historic Commission. I'd like to have that done. You can't, so that nobody can do that. Thank you.
Perkins.
Reverend Perkins, this question appeared several times in your box. It's quite long, but I'm going to paraphrase it for you. You alluded in a question earlier that there were mistakes made with the police department when you were mayor. What will you do to reestablish those relationships and build morale when you were mayor?
I think I have been doing that already. I don't feel that I have a poor relationship with the police department and police officers in the city of Selma. There are mending processes going on every day. I think the work that was done with ceasefire contributed to the mending process. I think the things that we do when we have prayer with the officers, I think that contributes to the process. I don't see the police department as an enemy. Yes, I did make some mistakes while I served this board, but I will assure you that anybody who's doing anything at all is going to make a mistake every now and then. I will tell you that there were more successes than there were mistakes. Police officers have not had a raise since I left office beyond the incentive, the annual incentive that's provided. I will make sure that the public safety, because listen, this is an elephant in the room. Police officers are under attack all across this country. And we have to be very careful. Those of us who are aspiring to be mayor, it is awfully difficult to try and balance that scale between the community's needs and interests and the interest within the police department. But the fact that I have gone down that road and I have had the opportunity to see what works and what does not, I think that makes me the most qualified person to deal with this issue in this day and time.
Martin.
Ms. Martin, this question has two parts. One, as a citizen, what contributions have you made to the economy of the city, and what are some of the specifics of your economic development plan?
Sure. So the first part, the money that I've brought into Selma has been almost over $500,000, and this has been through grants that we've received to actually get youth and young adults that job skills training that they need in actual allergy to work the jobs that are already here in Selma. And what was the second part of that question?
What are some of the specifics of your economic development plan?
Okay, thank you. I'm so glad you asked that question. Some of the specifics of my economic development plan centers around what all modern smart cities are doing right now, and that's focusing on three main infrastructures. You have your hard infrastructure, your soft infrastructure, and the new one is our technical infrastructure. So thank God we already have in place our fiber optic program that was done back in 2014, but we've yet to see the fruit of that labor. So I want to put to use all of the resources we already have and put together that soft infrastructure behind our hard infrastructure, which is that legal and policy framework, so that we can have a better economy that our millennials will be attracted to, that businesses will be attracted to, and that will just breed a better business-friendly environment here in Selma. And so that also will tie into my $4 million plan to raise the city's revenue by $4 million each year. So by 2020, $4 million is raised.
Up next, closing statements will go in this order: Martin, Perkins, Belkin, Melton, Evans. And you will each have 2 minutes for your closing statement. And within your statement, we would like you to address the following question: how will you be accountable to the citizens of Selma? Ms. Martin.
I will be accountable to the citizens of Selma by always making myself as your mayor available. You know, backstage just a few moments ago, I was asked by one of the candidates, actually told by one of the candidates, that they're going to find me a husband. And this is really offensive to me, guys, because you see, I'm ready, I'm willing, and I'm committed to give 110% of myself to Selma. I don't have kids, no, I'm not married. I am going to give, I am prepared to give every bit of myself to Selma. And that's how you know that I will be held accountable, because I will continue on doing the work that I've already done in our churches, in our jail, in our communities, that this is what a fresh start will look like. A woman, a single woman, giving up herself to strengthen her city.
Mr. Perkins.
This is the funny statement. Is my time starting now? Thank you. The citizens of Selma, none of us on this stage will fix Selma. What's gonna fix Selma is the decision that you make about this election. And you're going to have to vet all of us to determine who has the most experience, integrity, and vision to move our city from where it is today to where we desire it to be. Vision from God that has flowed into my heart, into my head. I have put it on paper and on electronic media. When you walk out of here, if you don't already have a copy, one will be outside waiting for you. My commitment on accountability is simply this. I have put my vision on paper, 16 pages of it. That's what Selma needs to hold me accountable for doing when I enter the office of mayor. Finally, I will say this, that the office of mayor, the job of the office of mayor, is to manage $20 million and 300 employees when you probably really need $25 million to do the job. I believe Mayor Evans will probably say amen to that, because he has the experience and been there and understands this process. We must not, I think there are some smart people on this stage and in the audience, but it's not about speeches. This is about who has the capacity to manage this city. I say to you that I have the experience to manage an organization this size. Selma, you have to decide whether you choose to turn our community over. Wow. God bless you. Love you so much. Thanks for the opportunity.
Mr. Milton.
I stood before you today. You've heard a lot of my concerns, but I want everyone to know that I truly love Selma, and I know that Selma can be great again. accountability to the citizens of Selma. I promise to serve all the people of Selma. I don't care what side of town. August 23rd, the nation will be watching. Let us, I want everyone to know, we are not horses here. We don't have a bit and bridle. You don't know how, you don't have to be told how to vote, where to go. You know how to vote. You know what needs to be done. I know what needs to be done. August 23rd, I want to see, I know that I want your vote so that I can make a change in Selma. I know it can be done. I've known Selma. It can be done. And I insist that it can be done again. Give me your vote. I'll give you the chance. I will show you. Thank you.
Mr. Miller.
The overall question tonight is, what does Selma future look like? Imagine a city where senior citizens can live out their golden years without having been robbed by a young person. Imagine with me a city where we are the premier city of the Alabama, not just the Black Belt. Imagine with me a city where our kids are growing and thriving and can say they didn't just live in Selma, but they thrive in Selma. Yes, electing a mayor is more than about having a messiah or a manager. You elect a mayor for a vision, for a budget, and for a plan. You hire good people around you and your department hands to manage what goes on in the day-to-day operation of the city. Right outside of Selma, we have a sign that says, history heals itself. And it does. From the Civil War to the Voting Rights Movement, to the two gentlemen that flanked me, first Black superintendent, first Black president of the city council, and the first Black mayor. Yes, history does live itself, but history is not to be relived, it's to be remembered. Step into our future.
Questionnaire online, I come by all like the church, give us feedback. How many people participated? About 600 to 700 out of 20,000 people. Now, I asked the citizens of Selma to give me feedback on what you think about what's going on in the city, and then about 500 or 600 or 700 maybe gave it back. Now, I think that we too ought to be accountable about what we expect for everybody, and actually giving feedback to city government for the sake of making sure we cover all the bases. Now, the feedback we did get, maybe had all our departments getting help. And I have no problem with that, because at the end of the day, we have a lot of work to do. I have no problem doing that work. Let me say to you that I love Selma. I believe in Selma, and I believe in you. I'm going to say to all of you, on the 23rd of August, I need your vote. I know that I have reached out to help a lot of people, and you know who you are. And I have never asked for anything back in return other than to do what you say you was going to do. So all I ask of you now, to help me to get back to the office where I can continue to finish the job that we're doing with the sole purpose of continuing to move our city forward. It can be done. I know how to do it with your help, and with God's help, we can make our city the proudest and brightest city of all the universe. Thank you so much.
And with that concludes the Selma Mayoral Debate. Can we give our candidates a round of applause?